Elisa. Introduction. Immunoassays are based on antigen-antibody reactions. They are used for measurement of hormones, drugs, viral serological markers in the form of antibodies or antigens, etc.
The immunoassays are of different types based upon the immunodetection markers which are used. For example, when the immunoassay is radioimmunoassay, what we call a RIA, the marker is a radioisotope. When it is enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, what we call ELISA, the marker is an enzyme. And a chemiluminescence-based immunoassay, what we call CLIA, is also having an enzyme marker. An immunofluorescence assay, IFA, has a fluorescent dye or a fluorophore as a marker.
Here, we will be discussing the ELISA methodology. Principle. ELISA is a plate-based assay technique which is used for detecting and quantifying substances such as peptides, proteins, antibodies, and hormones. An enzyme conjugated with an antibody reacts with colorless substrate to generate a colored product. Such substrate is called chromogenic substrate.
A number of enzymes have been used for ELISA. For example, with the reporter enzyme being horseradish peroxidase or HRP, two different chromogenic substrates can be used. When the chromogenic substrate is O-phenyldiamine hydrochloride, what we call OPD, it can have two wavelengths, the primary being 450 nanometers and the secondary wavelength being 490 nanometers. For the same reporter enzyme, HRP, when the chromogenic substrate is tetramethylbenzidine or TMB, the wavelengths there are 630 nanometers for primary and 450 for secondary wavelength. When the reporter enzyme is alkaline phosphatase, AP, the chromogenic substrate is PNPP, which is P-nitrophenylphosphate. Here, the primary wavelength is 405 and the secondary wavelength is the same, 405 nanometers. When the reporter enzyme is beta-galactosidase, BGAL or beta-gal, the chromogenic substrate there is O-nitrophenyl beta-D-galactopyranosidase, ONPG. Here again, the primary wavelength and secondary wavelength are the same at 420 nanometers.
Methodology. ELISAs are typically performed using 96 well polystyrene plates. The serum is incubated in a well and each well contains a different serum.
Positive control sera and negative control sera would also be included among the 96 samples being tested.
Antibodies or antigens present in serum are captured by corresponding antigen or antibody coated onto the solid surface. After some time, the plate is washed to remove serum and unbound antibodies or antigens using wash buffer. To detect the bound antigens, a secondary antibody that is attached to an enzyme such as peroxidase or alkaline phosphatase is added to each well. After an incubation period, the unbound secondary antibodies are washed off. When a suitable substrate is added, the enzyme reacts with it to produce a color. This color produced is measurable as a function of quantity of antigens or antibodies present in the given sample. The intensity of color or optical density is measured at fixed filter wavelength. The intensity of the color gives an indication of the amount of antigen or antibody. Types of ELISA. Commonly, there are four types of ELISA on the basis of binding structure between the antibody and the antigen. 1. Direct ELISA. 2. Indirect ELISA. 3. Sandwich ELISA. 4. Competitive ELISA. Direct ELISA. Direct ELISA has the simplest format requiring antigen to be adsorbed to the plate and then bound by a labeled detection antibody. Direct refers to the first and only antibody acting as both the antigen recognition molecule and signal delivery molecule. Advantage: simplicity and speed. Disadvantage: lower sensitivity. Indirect ELISA. An indirect ELISA detects the plated antigen with an unlabeled antibody, which is then detected with a secondary antibody carrying the means of signaling. By utilizing a secondary antibody for signal delivery, indirect ELISA formats allow for use of a modular secondary antibody that recognizes the constant region of the primary antibody. Advantage: labeled secondary antibodies can be utilized across many different ELISAs and the primary antibody need not be modified. Increased sensitivity, as the polyclonal antibodies bind 2 to 3 secondary sites, amplifying the signal per each primary antibody. Cost savings, since fewer labeled antibodies are required. Disadvantages: cross-reactivity might occur with the secondary antibody, resulting in non-specific signal. An extra incubation step is required in the procedure. Sandwich ELISA. The differentiating feature of a sandwich ELISA is the adsorption of a capture antibody to the plate. Antigen is bound or captured by the plated antibody and then sandwiched between the capture and a detective antibody, which recognizes a distinctly different epitope on the antigen. Finally, substrate is added to the plate, which is hydrolyzed by enzyme to form colored products. Advantages: high specificity and the ability to measure antigen from impure sample. Suitable for complex samples, since the antigen does not require purification prior to measurement. Competitive ELISA. It is similar to a direct ELISA in that antigen can be directly adsorbed to the plate. However, the detecting antibodies are pre-incubated with samples containing unknown amounts of antigen. After the well is washed, enzyme-conjugated secondary antibody specific for isotype of the primary antibody is added to determine the amount of primary antibody bound to the well. Samples with more antigen will occupy binding sites on the primary antibody, thereby blocking it from binding to plated antigen. Conversely, samples with less antigen will have more antibodies available to bind to the plated antigen and return a higher signal. Advantages: high specificity, since two antibodies are used. High sensitivity, since both direct and indirect detection methods can be used. Suitable for complex samples, since the antigen does not require purification prior to measurement. Capture ELISA. A similar technique to sandwich ELISA is a capture ELISA, which uses an avidin-biotin complex to retain antigen to the plate. By adsorbing large tetrameric protein, avidin-biotin labeled antigen can be immobilized, yet avoid adverse plate antigen interaction. Additionally, avidin-biotin capture distances the antigen from the plate. Increasing the distance from the plate allows for three-dimensional access to the antigen, whereas direct plating could sterically obscure access to epitopes. Reagent and equipment required: ELISA reader, ELISA washer, pipette, multi-channel or single channel, incubator, reagent kit containing sample wells. ELISA reader. ELISA readers are special photometric analyzers with ability to take photometric readings on individual wells in a microplate. It works on the photometric principle with vertically mounted optics, light source and detector. Similar to photometer, ELISA readers are microprocessor controlled and various analyte programs can be pre-programmed in the reader. Calibration control data can usually be stored in onboard memory. Calibration of the ELISA reader. The calibration of a microplate reader is a specialized process which must be executed by a trained engineer. In order to do the calibration, it is necessary to have a set of gray filters mounted on a plate of equal geometric size to those used in the analysis. Manufacturers provide these calibration plates for any wavelength the equipment uses.
Each calibration plate comes with a set of predefined reference values for each wavelength with appropriate traceability. The plate is then checked on the reader to be calibrated, and the recovered values are checked against the reference values. Any discrepancy can be corrected by the technical support team. It is essential to get a certificate of calibration as shown in this picture. This also will show the next due calibration date.
Maintenance. Elisa readers require minimal user maintenance. Routine user performed maintenance is confined to keeping the microplate carriage area clean of any spillage and dust.
Clean the carriage rail to prevent oxidation or rusting that affects the plate movement. For software-driven systems, equipment self-check will alert the user to any compromise in the system. However, users of non-software-driven systems need to monitor their systems more vigilantly. WHO recommends additional steps in the daily maintenance schedule available online. The learner may read further on this. This video discusses the bare minimum required.
Decontamination is recommended using 0.5% bleach solution in case of spill, achieving maximum performance of Elisa readers. Microplate should be clean and free of dust or scratches at the bottom.
Avoid careless handling, especially when using partial plates. Accuracy of pipetting has a huge impact on the results. Use calibrated pipettes. Calibrate them every 6 to 12 months. The calibrating agency should be ISO 17025 certified. Multi-channel pipettes are preferable for Elisa. Use well-fitting tips. Do not bang or slam the pipette into the tips. Pipette against the sidewall or into the already present liquid.
The micro well should have minimum 100 microliters of liquid for better results. The inclination of the meniscus can cause loss of accuracy, especially with small volumes. Agitate the microplate before reading. Elisa washers. The microplate washer performs the washing of the Elisa plate's wells during the different stages of the technique. The microplate washer supplies cleaning buffers required for the Elisa technique in a controlled manner. The washer has two reservoirs, one for the washing buffer, the other for the waste generated during the washing process. Microplate washing is one of the most critical steps in Elisa procedure. Inadequate or non-uniform washing step could lead to major errors in accuracy and precision. The washers are microprocessor controlled, and volume of wash, time duration of cycle can be programmed. Automated plate washer employs 8 pairs of tubes. Onset for dispensing wash solution. Other set to aspirate the contents. Elisa washer. The microplate washer is critical for accuracy of test performance. It includes the following aspects. Position of the needles, supply and aspiration head. The adjustment with respect to the wells must be verified. The needles must never be allowed to touch the bottom of the wells to avoid mechanical damage. Aspiration time must be appropriately be adjusted. Also, check that the suction system's needles are clean, that is free of obstructions. Distributed volume has to be calibrated. Vacuum. The suctioning system must be calibrated efficiently. The majority of washers function with a vacuum ranging between 60 and 70% of atmospheric pressure. Preventive maintenance. Microplate washer. Cleaning the washer components on a regular basis is critical to keep the washer running efficiently. The recommended frequency for cleaning washer components is at least monthly. Non-compliance to this may lead to improper washing and contamination and carryover. General routine maintenance includes rinsing and soaking the fluid path and cleaning the washer's various components. The following table suggests usual maintenance schedule. General procedure for Elisa testing. The procedure will vary for every test parameter and manufacturer. The procedure to be followed should be based on the manufacturer's instruction and should be validated before being put in use for the patient sample. The general procedure includes the following steps. Bring all the reagent and test specimen at room temperature. Define the test sample and control distribution and identification plan of the plate wells for each run. The entire plate can be used or use only the required number of wells. The balance unused wells can be wrapped and stored. Add required volume of sample diluents, controls and sample to the wells and mix well. Cover the wells with strip sealers and black cover and incubate it at temperatures ranging between room temperature and 37 degrees Celsius for a determined period of time according to the test requirement. During the incubation, the sample's antigen binds to the antibody coated to the plate, or the antibody in the sample binds to the antigen coated on the plate. After incubation, the unbound antigen or antibodies are washed and removed from the plate by the microplate washer using an appropriate washing buffer. Every time, invert the plate and tap it on absorbent pad to remove the excess washing solution. Next, the conjugate, which is the secondary antibody, is added. This harbors an enzyme which reacts with the substrate to produce a change of color at a later step. Then begins a second period of incubation, during which the conjugate will bind to the antigen-antibody complex in the wells. After the incubation, a new washing cycle is done to remove unbound conjugate from the wells. Every time, invert the plate and tap it on absorbent pad to remove the washing solution. A substrate is added. The enzyme reacts with the substrate and causes the solution to change in color. This will indicate how much antigen-antibody complex is present at the end of the test. Once the incubation time is completed, a reagent is added to stop the enzyme-substrate reaction and to prevent further changes in color. This reagent is generally a diluted acid. Finally, the plate in is read by the microplate reader.
The resulting values are used to determine the specific amounts, that is quantitative, or the presence, that is qualitative, of antigens or antibodies in the sample.
Test calibration.
Some of the wells are used for standards and controls in every run.
Standards or calibrators allow the data points at different concentrations to be defined. The standards have known values which are fed into the equipment. The equipment uses the data from these calibrators to plot the curves. For biochemical tests for which quantitative value is required in the reports, adequate calibrators ensure more accurate reports. The frequency of calibrations depend on the stability of the reagents. The lab has to develop calibration protocols, keeping this in mind. Manufacturers' guidelines may be used to give an idea regarding the reagent stability.
Most qualitative ELISA kits which are used in microbiology do not come with calibrators.
Cutoff values are entered manually depending on which the equipment decides if the test sample is positive or negative. Each kit manufacturer has devised a method of calculation that produces a cutoff value to classify a test specimen as positive or negative. Thus, a cutoff value can be based on an average of the negative controls multiplied by a factor, or is based on a relationship of positive controls to optimize sensitivity and specificity of the assay. Performance variables of ELISA. ELISA tests are generally easy to perform but require careful adherence to procedures. Any deviation in incubation time and/or temperature and the pipetted volume can dramatically influence the test results. To validate the test, all kit controls as specified in the kit insert must be included with each test run. It is very important to use controls in Elisa. Controls have known values and are used for detecting errors in the analytical system. In case of quantitative tests, all clinical decision levels should be checked with controls to detect errors. In case of qualitative tests, negative, positive, and borderline positive controls must be employed. More about this can be learned from the discussion on quality controls. Quality controls for ELISA or EIA.
For qualitative tests, negative and positive, that is internal controls, are available with the kit and shall be used with each run.
In addition, laboratories shall use a commercial control or an external control with a value close to the cutoff for the test, borderline reactive. In-house preparation of positive control, that is borderline reactive, external to the kit.
Please refer to the Annexure 1 of the training module on quality control, Volume 2, for more details on the preparation and validation of in-house positive control, where it is borderline reactive. The learner may also refer the user's manual of the Quality Control Toolkit, QCSoft, on this website.